Congrats, Rana. I just have one question first, that whenever someone from out of Kashmir goes to Kashmir, they just find out the Dal, the Pari Mahal, the Mughal Gardens, and the Pahalgam, and the Gulmarg ski. So what first introduced you to Kashmir, other than the MC Kash, which you said that you heard his music at friend's place? Was there something else?
Well, I've never been there before, so that was my first time there. I had a completely clean slate. I mean, obviously I had read and heard a lot about Kashmir over the years from a mainstream media perspective, which is inherently somewhat biased, of course, and focuses on very particular elements of what's been happening there. But, I wanted to explore it from the perspective of Roshan. I wanted to see his Kashmir from his eyes, and that's why I had him conduct most of the interviews with these people. So that was the kind of tool that I employed.
So why did you only choose these people, Parveena and Roshan?
I didn't choose them. What happened is that, I got there. I should back up. I heard the record and some of his music, I should say. And about 2 days after, I contacted his manager, who's actually a friend of
mine. Yeah.
So there was a Facebook page, and there was a number. So I called the number, and that was Shah's number. We met in Kashmir at a coffee shop, and for the first 3 days, I didn't even take out my camera. No question of that. I just wanted to hang out, basically.
So. Yeah, that can also be seen in the film that there are some shots which seem like to be behind the scenes shots which you have put in the film.
There's a lot of that, yeah. But initially, I didn't want to make it feel as though I was just another journalist wanting to focus on a sort of superficial element of who he is or what he's been doing. So, I didn't welcome him initially at all to begin with. But over the course of those 3 days, we and his friends were talking about what we could do, and between me and Damien is the other guy who I shot,
yeah.
But you know Damien obviously. We decided that he should meet Parveena.
Okay.
So it started with that, and then through Parveena we met many other people, and it built from there. And of course, it wasn't a plan for him to write a song about his experience meeting Parveena, but that's what happened. And so that song, Kingdom of Blood, was composed over the course of those 2 weeks. And of course, that's the song that.
And how long it took to make the film? Because I saw you shooting last year when I met you.
It was a long time ago. I didn't start editing until August this year. I was working on a number of other projects all year, so I started in August. And I don't know, I guess it took me about a month.
Okay. Other than the movie, you said that you went first time to Kashmir. Did you find the change, what you were hearing when you were not in Kashmir and when you went to Kashmir and saw yourself? Or did you find the change in it?
I don't know.
You just said the mainstream media was giving the biases, weren't you?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know about change, because I don't have anything to personally compare it to, but as it was my first visit, but I think what it did validate from your observations is exactly how tense and paranoid the situation really is. I mean, nobody really trusts anybody else for the most part, apart from people that you know well, but even that can be tested sometimes, the level of paranoia.
So are there any questions?
It is very heartening, and I fully sympathize with the mothers in Kashmir. And you have brought up that point very well, for a struggle that is going on for the last 20 years. Wonderful. I would like to know about Mr. Kash and his literature, whatever he has written. See, the feeling is more deep when you are being killed by your own people. And that is where this comes. Has Kash written about the mothers whose sons were killed and daughters were raped by the LET and Pakistan-sponsored agencies?
I'll answer to that.
I
can answer
no,
that.
No, why not?
See, Kash is inspired by, as you've seen, he's inspired by Parveena. He's inspired to a certain section of the society, the people who are killed by the Indian forces.
So only by the Indian forces, not by the militants.
So he's representing them.
Yeah,
so let me answer. He's representing them. So there are other, as I told you outside also, when you asked me the same question outside, I told you that, you said that why isn't he shown the people who are killed by anybody or somebody else? So I said that, have you seen Mission Kashmir or Lama or any, or Roja for that matter? So those are the major three Bollywood films in, on those issues. So he is just an independent filmmaker, he made a movie on them.
He is not, that is
okay. Any other reactions from you, anyone?
Not to be moved by their stories. So he has this way of, articulating their sorrow.
When you talk about the victims of this enforced disappearances or involuntary disappearances, I think the film focuses on a couple of represent a particular side of the story. They try to cover this the stories which are more horrible. I have done it. I have interviewed a number of ladies, a number of people, and I think the film would have been more powerful had they tried to. That's what I want to say.
Well, lexicon, but what do you call all those people who come from the other side of the border in English?
My point is the movie
aimed at projecting a side of the story where an organization, an entity which is supposed to protect you, is indulging in a particular act not known to have been, not known to be actually followed by the entity. When you call somebody a terrorist, you know terrorist lexicon means terrorism. You cannot club a state with terrorism. So the movie actually portrays that people who are subjects of a particular constitution, as per the state, who are your nation holders, as per you, who belong to an identity as per again the state, are treated as the same way as a terrorist would treat them. So you are yourself raising the line between the person you call a terrorist and between the entity you call a state. They have grievances against the state because the state upholds the basic fundamental right of life, promised life. When you hold a passport, it says in the name of the Republic, by the order of the President of India, I give you authority to travel and in any distress or whatever, all that. In the second page of the preamble of the Constitution, you read what it says. It upholds the right and integrity of life. The terrorist does not conform to your preamble. There lies the difference between the institution and the individual. So you cannot mix up his film because he has written about atrocities committed by the state. Hence, he is culpable of being one-sided and he is not written about something committed by a ragtag army and an individual.
My comment was aptly supported by other person from Kashmir, which says, if a movie is to project something, it need not be one-sided. That's it.
Thank you very much, sir.
To the question is, I don't understand why very often, when we speak about Kashmir, we have to be apologetic about making the argument we are making, or anything against the state of India. You have to begin with this blessed apology. Oh, I'm sorry that I haven't represented all sides of the story. Every story has I'm just going to lose my temper now. But Rana, I'm sorry, I must have missed the initial bit of the session. But I'd like to know a little bit more about you as well. Do you live in India?
Jason, he answered that in the beginning. You missed that bit. You can continue to that. He's from Canada. Hold on.
I didn't mean to have this question cut short, but actually, I was just going to repeat what he said. I don't see any reason for a film to particularly show every side. There's a value to having one side represented, and sometimes that side needs to strike us in the face a little bit harder than it has done before.
This MC Kash person was appropriate for the film because I think you should have picked someone that the Kashmiris could actually relate to. It just seemed like just off.
I guess when I started documenting Rosha, it wasn't actually to document the story that I ended up doing. It was more about him. but he's embedded in that context. That's where he's from. And that's what he wanted to actually relate to and understand better for his own benefit. I think, you know, in his music, if you're familiar with his music, his lyrics address these characters, but prior to this film, he had not actually met many of these people. And I found it very interesting that someone who claims to, well, maybe not claims to represent a particular perspective or experience, but at least narrates them to an audience, has not actually engaged with them very much. I mean, that in itself I found very interesting. And so perhaps, I mean, legitimacy again is always up for grabs and can be debated, but I was particularly interested in that dynamic between these, between Roshan and these people that he met. And I think the film actually brought that dynamic out in the sense of him encountering and negotiating what these people were saying with his own understanding of what he has grown up with. So, I mean, that's what I would.
Can you introduce yourself, please? Yeah. I'm Afsana Rashid. I'm a journalist based in Srinagar. I have been associated with various local, national media, and I have worked with some international news websites as well. Apart from that, I have, in 2011, written a book. It's about these widows and half-widows. And half-widows, as the question was raised, it's regarding women whose husbands, they have disappeared and they don't know their whereabouts. Years together. So they are living in a sort of identity crisis. They don't know whether they are dead or whether they are alive. So that is the problem, because that has brought them, not only these women, they have suffered not only on the social and the economic front, but their own identity. They don't know whether they have, whether they are widows or whether they are not widows. That's why we call them half widows. So what was prior to me to write this book was that once I used to, because I have been in this field since 2002 in the field of reporting. So I used to cover these protest demonstrations, these monthly protests by this APDP group. And once I used to meet these women, I used to do that hard kind of a story that this happened, but simultaneously I met these women and I used to see that what are the problems that these women face, and over the years I thought that it's better, that it's a sort of a responsibility and it's a, it would be a sort of a contribution for the society. Why not to do stories, why not to visit these women? These women individually and see what their problems are. So my that's based on that very thing. But I went to women, I went to various areas in Kashmir, be it Kupwara, be it Bandipora, be it Pulwama, and I spoke to these women. I even went to Uri and spoke to women about their problems and how they are living their lives. That book is all about that. I had a I have a book with me, but unfortunately I'm not carrying it this time.